Okay, hello everyone, and in this video we're going to be looking at motion and what it means in a sense of one dimension. So, you know, things that can move from left to right or up and down, and we're going to get a better understanding of how we can actually apply this idea of velocity and acceleration to the derivatives of different functions. So let's say we're given a function here, it's a displacement function. Well, we know, based on the previous video that I did about motion graphs at the beginning of this Applications of Differential Calculus sort of video series, that the S prime of t, so the first derivative of this displacement function, is going to be the velocity function. And then what we do from that is we differentiate this function, as I said, to get the first derivative. So we have 3 multiplied by a third, so that's t, and then raised to the power of 2, because again, we subtract 1 from the exponent. And now what we do is we take away, and it's 4 times 2 to get 8t to the power of 1 plus 12. So again, we're just differentiating it there. Hopefully you're comfortable with this concept, so I'm going to need to move through the differentiating process reasonably quickly. So again, remember, velocity is just the first derivative of the displacement function. Because if you had a displacement graph and you took the gradient off it, you get the velocity. Now the S prime prime of t, so the second derivative of the displacement function, which is also the V prime of t, which is the first derivative of velocity, is again the acceleration. So what we can do is we can differentiate it again and get 2t minus 8, and from that we have our velocity and acceleration functions. And generally, that's the most common thing to start off with. You'd start off by working out, okay, what's the velocity and what's the acceleration from that? Okay, so now we would have a look at maybe what would be happening to this little particle or something that's moving in 1D at time equals 0, for example. Maybe you might need to survey it at a different time. All you really need to do is substitute in the value that you're given, whether it's 0 or a numerical value like 2 or 4, to be able to find out what's happening at that given point in time. And then you need to draw logical conclusions based on the numbers that you're given, and maybe write a sentence or two. So, what's happening at time equals 0? Well, the S of 0 is going to be 1 third of 0 to the power of 3. Take 4 lots of 0 squared plus 12 lots of 0. So this placement is going to be 0, and therefore the particle or object in motion starts at the origin. And how do we know it starts the origin? Well, if we think about it, if the displacement is 0, then it must be at the original location. So in this case, we generally define it as the origin. Negative displacement values mean it's to the left of the origin, and positive means to the right. Think of it like a Cartesian plane, but with only like the x-axis there. That's sort of an easy way to visualize it. Okay, so we know what's happening to our displacement at time equals 0. Our displacement is equal to 0, so we're at the origin. Or, for example, if this was put in another context, if it was an elevator going up and down, then that would be at the ground floor, or something like that. So we know, depending on context, that we're starting sort of at the origin with our object in motion. Really, it could be a variety of different things. So now we find the V of 0, and again, we just take our velocity function we worked out from differentiation before, and we have 0 to the power of 2, take 8 lots of 0 plus 12. So what does this mean? Therefore, the velocity when t equals 0, so the initial starting time, is going to be equal to 12 meters per second right. And we know it's moving to the right because, again, it's a positive velocity of 12 meters per second. So, again, we know that the positive direction is to the right and the negative direction is to the left. And now, from this, we have the acceleration function, when we're at time equals zero again for acceleration. So what we have here is we have 2t take 8, so 2 lots of 0 take 8, and therefore the acceleration when t equals 0, so at the initial conditions, we have negative 8 meters per second squared. Again, acceleration is meters per second per second, and that would mean that it's decelerating. And it would also mean that the speed is decreasing over that interval, and I'll touch up on what that concept actually means in a moment, but essentially, if we have a positive velocity and we have a negative acceleration, so a deceleration, think of it in that regard. But if the signs are different, so, you know, positive here and negative there, between those two values, then we know that an object is actually decreasing in speed. And again, I'll come back to why that is a bit later, just to touch up on that bit of knowledge there, but it's something interesting to consider. And there we go, we have our S of an RV and our A at time equals zero, and we know that the object's at the origin, it's going to be moving to the right, but it's also got a negative acceleration, so it's going to be slowing down as it moves to the right. So we've got a bit of an idea of what's happening to the object, and again, we haven't been really using that much of mass that's difficult in some regard. We've just been substituting in values, and we've just been taking derivatives, things we're very comfortable with. It's more getting your head around the concepts behind it, such as when I said, okay, the movement to the left or the movement to the right, and whether the object's actually slowing down or not. But again, it does take a little bit of practice, but you'll get there eventually. The maths is easy, the understanding of it is more of the difficult part. Okay, so now from this, we can move on to another question here, and the next question asks us to find at what time the elevator actually reverses direction. Okay, so in order to find this out, we need to draw a sine diagram, because when the velocity is going to be equal to zero, then that's when we're actually going to have a change in direction, when velocity equals zero. So in order to do this, we take our velocity function, t squared minus 8t plus 12, and what we do is we actually factorise it, because again, factorising it gives us our roots of the equation. Now in order to factorise this, it's just a simple quadratic, so we know that we can have t and t in there, and from that we just need to sort of piece together what's happening. Let's see, we're trying to get a product of 12 and an actual sum of 8, or negative 8 should I say. So if that's the case, we've got to think about numbers that would suit that circumstance, and well, in this context we can think of negative 6 and negative 2, because negative 6 times negative 2 is going to make 12, positive 12, because 2 negatives make positive. And negative 6 take 2 is equal to negative 8, so we're able to actually factorise it there. And because both of those equal 0, the time at which the velocity is equal to 0 is going to be t equals 2 and t equals 6. That's both when the velocity is going to be equal to 0. So, from that, what we can do is we can construct a sine diagram. Sine diagrams are really, really good at telling us what's happening to that function, or what's happening to the original function, whether it's an increasing or decreasing value. Now, you're probably thinking, okay, how does when the velocity equals 0 actually tell us that the object is reversing direction? Well, think about it this way. We're actually taking the slope of S of t, and if the slope changes from negative to positive of the S of t function, the actual displacement, then doesn't that mean it's changing direction? Because it's, you know, it's got a positive direction and then it's turning into a negative direction, or a negative change, a negative slope. So you just got to sort of think of it in that regard. You've got to think of it as, okay, the velocity function tells us what's happening to the slope on the displacement function, and therefore when we have a stationary point on the displacement function, it's actually going to be a turning point in the context, because of course there's going to be a change. The object's actually going to turn around, and the rate of change in the displacement given by the velocity, is going to change, isn't it? Just have a little think about that for a moment and sort of let that sink in. But again, these sine diagrams will tell us whether it's going to be a positive increasing sort of slope value for the S of t function, then when it's going to be negative, and that kind of thing. So it can give us a sense of what's actually happening in terms of the motion of the object, and it helps with constructing a motion diagram, which I'll go through in just a moment as well. But in terms of a sine diagram, I'll probably want to get a whiteboard marker that actually works. But after doing that, essentially what we do is we have that. In fact, I'll probably just label it as being V there, and we mark on 2 and 6. And then we just fill in the gaps. And filling in the gaps isn't too difficult because, again, it's just a matter of substitution. So in order to substitute this value in, well, let's think about it, something less than 2. Maybe let's find the velocity function when t equals 1. Okay, so the velocity when t equals 1, the v of 1 equals 1 squared, take 8 lots of 1, so I'm just going to leave that as 8 plus 12. So 1 take 8 is negative 7, so negative 7 plus 12, and that's equal to 5 there. So we have an actual positive displacement there, so the displacement is increasing before it gets to 2. Cool. So we've got an understanding of what's happening there. We can fill in our sine diagram. We can go, okay, I can sort of visualize this in my head. And again, it's starting to make a lot more sense as well as to what's actually happening in our function. So now we can take maybe the V of 3, perhaps, somewhere in between. And we can see 3 squared and then minus 8 lots of 3 is going to make 24 plus 12. So we have 9 take 24, and 9 take 24 is going to make negative 15. Negative 15 plus 12 is going to give us a negative 3. So from that, we know that there's a negative result in there. So it's changed direction, you know? Think about how it would actually look like as a displacement function in your head, this velocity function, because it is representing the slope of the displacement function. It's giving us an indicator of what's going on. So you can pretty much see that there, it has changed direction. And that's what the sine diagram is good for evaluating what's happening within a given interval. And now we can take the V of 7, for example. So we get 7 squared, which is 49, minus 8 lots of 7, which is 56, and then plus 12. So we end up with 49 take 56, gives negative 8 plus 12, makes positive 4. And then we can see that, yes, it's changed direction again, and it makes sense within the context. So it's gone from a positive to a negative, then back to a positive on our sine diagram. So I'll go over in the next video what that actually means, but hopefully you get a bit of an understanding behind what's actually going on there in terms of derivative. Just remember from this video about how we get the velocity function. It's the first derivative of our displacement function. So obviously when that vt function equals 0, we're going to work out when the direction is reversing, because of course it makes sense with the displacement representing what's actually happening to the object, where it's located, and obviously a change in where it's located, whether it's having a positive change per every second or a negative change. Think of that as in the sense of a derivative, so the vt function behind it, to be able to support that. And also remember that you can find out the initial conditions just by considering a few basic physics concepts. Is it left or right of the origin? And what's happening? Is it if you have two different signs, if the velocity and acceleration have two different signs, then it means it's decreasing in speed. And I'll go through what that last one means in the next video. But get your head around the basics of what we've gone through in this video and then progress to part 2. Thank you for listening, and have any questions, write them down below in the comments section.